A very good evening, guys. Today we are here to start our discussion about the non-ideal reactor system and the heterogeneous reaction system in CRE in our quick revision class sessions. Okay, so in non-ideal reactor system, we have already uploaded the video in detail, and for the heterogeneous reaction system also, we are already having a video on our YouTube channel. So the link I will share in the description of this video. So if you want to watch those videos in quite detail, you can watch there. Okay, and here, because this is a quick revision class, so we will discuss all these things briefly, not in the detail. So what is non-ideal reactor system? Okay, so what I'm going to do here in this session for these two important topics, see, both are easy and interesting ones, because we don't need to, there is no principle law as such, only the equations, read the question, use the equation, put the values and solve. That's type of question they ask in the exam. So few things should be clear in our mind, like the meaning of each and every term which we are using here. Second, the equations, obviously, and third, the graphs, the curves. Okay, the curves which are related to the topics. Okay, so first is non-ideal reactor system. So what is non-ideal reactor? See, non-ideal reactors and ideal reactors, we have discussed the designing of ideal reactors already. Here, if I talk about the reactors, so ideal reactors are those in which every molecule has same residence time, and non-ideal reactors are those in which different molecules have different residence time. Okay, and why there is a difference? Where molecules have different residence time. These are the non-ideal reactors. And why molecules have different residence time here? Because molecules follow different path, or you can say different flow path. Okay. And this different flow paths is basically because of the geometry of the reactor. This difference in flow path is because of the geometry of the reactor. Okay, now if I talk about the geometry of the reactor, so why there is a different flow path? So for that we have several reasons, like we can say the causes of non-ideality. So basically there are three causes of non-ideality mainly. First is the dead zone. Second is bypassing, and third one is turbulence. Okay, so what is dead zone, what is bypassing, and what is turbulence? Let's understand that. So dead zone means, you can say, the dead space, which is, dead space means in a reactor, what can be the dead space, what can be the dead zone? See, that part of the reactor which is not participating in the process. Okay, like if I talk about a rectangular tank and if there is a mixing going on. Okay, so we know that the mixing profile is usually parabolic. Okay, and in this case, if that is a rectangular bottom, so there must be some extreme corners. Okay, like the extreme corners we have in our house, in our rooms. Okay, whatever efforts you can put, but you cannot remove the entire amount of dust, each and every particle of dust from those extreme corners in your room. without using some machines. Okay, with the help of a cloth or anything you can do, but to remove each and every part from the extreme corners, we have to go with vacuum pumps. Okay, that is our different things. So if these are the extreme corners, so if any molecule by chance in the reactor, if any molecule got stuck in these extreme corners, so obviously that molecule will not participate in the process. And since that molecule is not participating in the process, so the probability of that molecule to leave the reactor becomes zero. Okay, and since the probability of the molecule to leave the reactor is zero, so we can say the residence time will be infinite. So molecule will stay inside the reactor for an infinite duration. Okay, so that is the meaning. If any molecule get trapped in the dead zone or stuck in the dead zone in any reactor or in any process vessel, the residence time of that molecule will become infinite. Okay, so I hope this is clear to all of you. Next is the turbulent bypassing. What is the meaning of bypassing? All of us know that bypass operations are those where some part of the inlet stream is directly sent to the outlet without passing through the process. Okay, means this is the process, but we don't want this part of the inlet stream to get processed. So we directly send this part of the inlet stream to the outlet by skipping the process. So this is what we call bypass operation. Similarly here, it may happen that if I talk about any mixed flow reactor, for example, okay, so logically a molecule should enter in the reactor, it should get mixed and then leave after processing. So that is the logic. Okay, but what happens, suppose if there is a molecule which is in a hurry, okay, jo bahut jaldi mein hai, jiske paas samay nahi hai duniya bhar ki moh maya mein padhne ka, so what will happen, the molecule will directly go in the outlet. It will enter in the reactor but directly will go in the outlet. Okay, so it will not spend sufficient time inside the reactor. So when the molecule is not spending the sufficient time, so obviously processing will not occur, there will not be any processing on that molecule. So we can say that molecule is technically skipping the process. That is basically the bypassing. And in this case, the residence time of the molecules will be very small, or you can say short residence time. Okay, and the third one is turbulence. Turbulence means if any molecule got stuck in the mixing zone or in the vortex. Okay, if you have heard the vortex formation for the mixing tanks. So if any molecule by chance got stuck in the vortex, okay, so obviously what will happen? It will keep on rotating, keep on mixing in this zone, and there will not be, the new molecule cannot enter in this zone until there is a space. Okay. Sorry. So new molecule will enter in this mixing zone only when there will be a vacancy. So since old molecules are already stuck in this, so there will not be a vacancy. So that's how the quality of mixing will be affected. That's a different story. That is the consequences of having vortex formation in the tank. But what happened here, if a molecule is stuck in this, so obviously it will spend a lot of time inside the system. And if I talk about the probability of that molecule to leave the reactor, so I cannot say that is zero, because ultimately this vortex is the part of the process. So molecule, if a molecule is stuck in the vortex, so it is ultimately participating in the process. So it will have some probability to leave the reactor, to leave the system at some point of time. And what will be that time? That residence time, that time will be quite large, larger than the average value. Okay, so that is the causes of non-ideality, and that's how the residence time of the molecules get affected based on the flow path, the geometry of the reactor molecules. So to overcome the dead zone problem, nowadays what is happening? Most of the mixing equipments are coming with the hemispherical or cylindrical bottoms. Okay, so those things you must have studied in process equipment design about the bottom of the equipments. Anyways, For the vortex formation, for the turbulence, you know we can use baffles so that there is no vortex, and if there is no vortex, there will not be any turbulence, and so on. So we can solve this part as well. Okay, and for the bypassing issue, what we can do for the bypassing issue to overcome this, we can slow down the inlet velocity. Okay, means we can decrease the flow rate here. When the flow rate decreases, the velocity of the molecules decreases, so obviously they will spend a sufficient time inside the tank. So that is, these are the remedies for all those things. Anyways, so I hope this is clear to all of you. These are the causes, and if you try to draw these residence time on a curve, okay, like here on x-axis we have residence time and on y-axis we have number of molecules. Okay, so because of the bypassing, some molecules are leaving in a shorter time. So this will be the curve. Some molecules will leave at average value. Some molecules will leave due to turbulence, and they will spend longer time, longer duration than the average value. And obviously some molecules are stuck in the dead zone, so they will never leave. Okay. So this is the curve, and here if you see, this is a kind of a distribution curve. So this study of this kind of curve is called residence time distribution. Okay, that is the RTD analysis we have to do. Okay, and here this long tail represents the dead zone, obviously. If this tail is not there, the curve is something like this. Okay, it is touching the x-axis, so we can say there is no dead zone. This is the mean residence time, this is due to turbulence, and this is due to bypassing. So the study of this curve is called residence time distribution, RTD analysis, and that's what we have to do. Okay, so for the RTD analysis, the first thing is we must have the RTD curve. And to have the RTD curve, we use a molecule called tracer. Okay, that is called third component because it is neither a reactant nor a product. Because if you try to find out the RTD curve for a reactor system, then you must have a molecule which is not participating in the reaction. Because feed molecules will participate in the reaction, obviously they will convert their identity, and it will be quite difficult, practically impossible to detect them. Okay, so that's why we have to use a third molecule which is not participating in the reaction and can follow the same path. So that molecule is called tracer, and the tracer should have many characteristics. The important ones are tracer characteristics. The important ones are, it should be chemically inert. Second, it should be easily detectable, obviously. And third, it should follow the same path as followed by the reaction mixture. And when this thing will happen, it will happen only and only when the molecule, the tracer, is completely miscible with the reaction system. So it should be completely miscible with the reaction system. Okay, other than this, if you want to write any essay, so you can add n number of points that it should be non-toxic, non-hazardous, non-inflammable, non-corrosive, it should not stick to the reactor walls, less expensive, easily available, blah blah blah. So many things are there which you can write down by yourself, okay, as per your knowledge. So that's not a big deal. So here the point is, we know we can draw the RTD curve, we can find out the RTD curve with the help of a tracer. Now the point is how to inject the tracer. So for that, in our syllabus we have only two methods, unfortunately. One is pulse input and second is step input experiment. Okay, so now let's talk about those two. pulse input experiment, or you can say pulse input method. So what is pulse input method? Pulse input method is, see, first let's draw the reactor arrangement, the setup. This is the reactor. We are sending the feed to this reactor. With the flow rate of V naught, suppose. And obviously here we are supposed to get the outlet product, leaving at the same flow rate. That is a steady state process. So here in the system, we introduce the tracer in the mixing valve, where the tracer gets mixed with the feed and enters in the reactor with the same flow rate, V naught. Okay. And since this is the pulse input experiment, so we inject the tracer in the form of a pulse. Like doctors used to inject the medicine in our body in form of pulse with the help of injection. Okay. So if you see the input of that medicine in our body, since they are injecting the medicine with the help of injection, so it will enter in the body, in our body, in a very small time. Okay, so if you try to draw the tracer input profile here, that will be something like this, the tracer input profile. Okay, so let's say we are injecting the N0 amount of tracer initially. We have N0 amount of tracer. We are injecting that in the system in one shot. Okay, and here in the outlet, we are detecting the tracer. And obviously, since RTD, since bypassing, dead zone, turbulence, so many reasons are there. So we will have the different concentration of tracer at different time. Okay, and if you try to draw, the CT represents the exit concentration of tracer. At time t. Okay, and if you try to draw this curve, you will find that the curve here, the tracer output profile, the tracer output profile भगवान क्या करूं मैं इसका इसकी सेंसिटिविटी भी ओके सो इफ यू ट्राई टू ड्रॉ द ट्रेसर आउटपुट प्रोफाइल सो इट विल बी समथिंग लाइक दिस ओके एंड इफ देयर इज अ डेड जोन सो देयर विल बी अ लॉन्ग टेल. Okay, and if there is no dead zone, so there will not be any long tail. And this curve, which we have drawn between exit concentration of tracer versus residence time, is known as C curve. And one thing should be clear in your mind, if we try to calculate the area of this C curve, okay, the area of this C curve, then that has to be constant. Okay, but we can calculate the area of C curve only when there is no dead zone or when we have the entire C curve. Okay, means when we have the bounded region. Like this. We have the bounded region. So, let's assume that at t equal to infinite, that is the time when all molecules will leave the reactor. So, if you try to, now see, you can see this is one bounded region. So here if you try to calculate the area, then the area of this C curve has to be a constant volume, value. Okay, it does not have, the area of C curve is not having any significance, but we should know that the area of this C curve will be constant. Okay, since this is based on the output values, and output values means result, and results are always constant. We cannot manipulate the results. Okay, like you have got, you must have got some percentage in your 10th, in 12th, in BTech, first semester, second semester, and so on. So if you try to draw a curve based on those values, so that curve will be a constant curve, and the area of that curve will be constant as well, because you can't change your result now. Okay, so similarly, this C curve is based on the output data. So tracer concentration at the outlet versus residence time. If you draw this curve, that is called C curve, only for the pulse input method. Okay, and here one thing should be clear to you. We define the exit age function. Exit age function to analyze this system. And that exit age function is ET, that is equal to V naught CT over N naught. This is one equation that should be clear to you. Where exit age may defined as, if anyone asks you what is exit age, so you should be able to tell him that by definition, exit age is different, but mathematically, biologically, chemically, psychologically, electrically, electronically, mechanically, by every other mean, it is same as the residence time, but by definition it is different. And what is exit age? Exit age has, we can define as the time taken by a molecule. Be clear about this. This is a microscopic parameter. So we have to define this in terms of molecule only. Time taken by a molecule to leave the reactor. And it's obvious that when molecule will leave the reactor, when we will talk about that molecule should leave the reactor, only when molecule has entered in the reactor. Okay, so time taken by a molecule to leave the reactor means when it is when the molecule has entered from there to this exit point, how much time the molecule is taking, that is the exit age. And if you see, the time spent by a molecule in this space is basically called the residence time as well. So exit age is nothing but just a other form, you can say a twin brother of residence time or twin sister, whatever you want to say. Okay, I'm not going to be a biased about the gender. So this is exit age function. And here one more thing should be clear to you, like if you see, V naught and N naught are the values, the input values, and that must be constant for any system. So it means ET is proportional to CT. So if you try to draw a curve between ET versus T, exit age versus function versus residence time, ET is the exit age function. If you try to draw a curve in this, so the nature of the ET versus T curve will be same as that of for CT versus T curve. So if C curve is like this, then ET curve will also be like this. And this curve is known as E curve. Only for the pulse input experiment. Okay. And what is this ET represents? See. This ET represents the fraction of tracer leaving the reactor at time t. At any particular time t, how much fraction of the tracer is leaving the reactor? That is represented by the ET. Okay, so we know that summation of fraction has to be 1. So if you try to find out the area of this E curve in total time interval, where this is from between 0 to infinite, So if you try to draw a curve between et versus time t in the total time interval, then the area of this curve will be 1 always. Remember this. Okay, why? Because area of E curve represents the fraction of tracer leaving the reactor in given time interval. Fraction of tracer leaving the reactor in given time interval. That is the significance of area of a E curve. Okay, what is E curve? E curve is the area between ET versus T. And since ET is proportional to CT, as we can see from here, so the nature of C curve and E curve will be same. So in any exam or anywhere, if it is given that for the given system, the C curve is something like this. Okay, so what will be the nature of E curve? So you can directly say that the nature of E curve will be similar to this. Okay, same as that. Only the values will be different, obviously, because of these constants, mathematical constants, but the nature will be same. So if C curve is triangular, E curve will be triangular. If C curve is rectangular, E curve will be rectangular, and so on. Okay, so I hope all this part is clear to all of you. The area of E curve, it will be 1 always. Remember this, in the total time interval. Why? Because the area of E curve represents the fraction of tracer leaving the reactor in given time interval. So that's why we know that the total fraction has to be 1. So in total time interval, the fraction leaving the reactor has to be 1. So that's why the area of E curve will be 1 always. Okay, so mathematically, if you want to represent this, you can say between 0 to infinity, this equation, integration of et dt, represents the area. So in total time interval, this value has to be 1. Okay, so in any exam or anywhere, if you just need to find out the area of E curve, then you should be clear in your mind that it has to be 1. Okay, so I hope this part is clear. There was a question in GATE exam which you can see. Even if you don't know anything about the RTD, but you just know one thing, that area of E curve has to be 1 always, then you can solve the questions. Okay, like there was a question, if we can see that. The question was in year 2015. Okay, this was the question. Okay, as you can see, the impulse response to a tracer pulse experiment for a flow is given. C curve is given. You can see in the figure, see, everything is given. The E curve is represented by which of the following options? Okay, so this is the C curve that is given, and if you see in this, there are four options where E curves are given, and we have to find out which of the corresponding E curve is the correct one. Okay, so even if you don't know anything, you can check the area of the E curve, and this question was there for 2 marks. Okay, like here, if you see, I don't know whether you are able to watch these values, read these values properly or not, but in you can see that. Okay, like here, if I see, this value is 0.25, this value is 2, this value is 4 and 0. So we know that area of triangle is what? Area of the triangle is half into base, that is 4 minus 0, 4, into height, that is 0.25. So here you can see this value is 0.5. So the area of this E curve is not 1. So this cannot be the answer. Similarly, you can check for all other values. And if you see for C, area is half into base, that is 4, into height, that is 0.5. You will see this is 1. So in only option C has area equal to 1. So this is the correct answer. Okay, C. Then this question was there for 2 marks. You can see such. we don't need to do anything. And here if you see, the statement is so big. Okay, such a quite a big statement, because in on computer screen you have to scroll down at least once to read this question completely. Okay, and the solution is simple. Just if we know that area of E curve is always 1 in the total time interval. Okay, so option C will be the correct answer for 2 marks. Now the point is, if I want to calculate E curve with the help of C curve, okay, if I want to calculate the values of ET at different times of t with the help of C curve, then how can I do that? It's also very easy. Okay, so for that you just need to use this equation, that ET is equal to CT over integration from 0 to infinite of CT into dt. And what is the denominator here? If you see, the denominator is nothing but just the area of C curve. Area of C curve. That has to be a constant value, as we know that. So since again this is constant, so ET is proportional to CT. This is one equation, one more equation which we know. And further, if you want to calculate the mean residence time, okay, the average residence time that can be denoted by T bar. So with the help of E curve, you can calculate T bar as integration from 0 to infinite T into ET dt, or otherwise from the C curve, if you want to calculate, then you can calculate from, just put the value of ET here and you will get T into CT dt over integration from 0 to infinite of CT into dt. So from the C curve you can calculate T bar, or from the E curve as well you can calculate T bar. So that's how you can calculate the mean residence time in pulse input experiments. Okay, it's very simple. And further, if you want to calculate the variance or standard deviation, then you know that standard deviation is nothing but just the difference between the value and the mean value, and variance is the square of standard deviation. So here the variance, if you want to calculate sigma square, then you can calculate as 0 to infinite t minus t bar whole square et dt. By using this expression you can calculate the variance. Okay, or otherwise if you expand this expression, since t bar has to be a constant value, mean value, so you can also write it as okay. And what is variance? So I hope all of you understand that variance signifies the distribution about mean value, distribution of the curve around mean value. Like if we have zero variance, then the curve will be like this. If we have low variance, then the curve will be something like this. If we have high variance, value of variance is quite large, then the curve will be something like this. The distribution about the mean value, as you can see, will increase. If high variance, high distribution, low variance, low distribution. So if someone asks you for the ideal pulse, ideal curve, what will be the variance? You can say simply zero. For the ideal reactors, what will be the variance? Simply zero. Because ideal reactor means all molecules have same residence time. So variance has to be zero. Okay, so this is all about the pulse input experiment which we should know, which we want to discuss. Okay, and I hope after this you can solve all the problems related to pulse input experiment. Okay, so let me take few gate preview questions based on this topic. for you so that you can understand. One more thing about the mean value. We know that graphically, what is the meaning of mean value? On a graph, if I talk about the mean value, then I can say mean value is the one which divides the curve into exactly two equal parts. Around the mean value, curve can be divided into two equal parts. Okay, so there was a question for 1 mark, 2 marks. This, where you have to calculate the mean residence time based on the given C curve. Okay, so if you wish, you can solve this mathematically. Otherwise, graphically, you can simply say that the mean residence time here will be 1. And if you check, you will see the area of these two parts will be same, exactly equal. So T bar will be 1 minutes or second, whatever it is. Seconds, okay. 1 second. That is the answer. Simple. We don't need to do anything. Simple. 1 mark, 2 marks secured. Okay. And mathematically, if you wish, you want to solve this, then again, you can solve that. That's not a big deal. So for that, I will discuss one more example, one more question. In this question, I'm not telling how to solve this mathematically. You can take the reference from there. Okay. Like in this question as well, question number 80, if you want to see the average residence time, mean residence time, so the value will be 7.5. Simple. And I hope it is clear to you. Okay, 7.5 will be the answer. This question again there for 2 marks. Simple. And if you want to calculate the mean residence time mathematically, then you can consider this question. This was asked in gate 2005 for 2 plus 2, 4 marks. See, E curve is given. In first part, you have to calculate E max. In second part, you have to calculate T bar. So how to calculate Emax? I don't know. We know one thing, that area of E curve has to be 1 in the total time interval. So here if you see area, that should be 1 and that should be equal to graphically half into base, that is 15 minus 3 means 12 into height, that is Emax. So from here you will get Emax is equal to 1 upon 6. 2 marks confirm. Such a difficult calculation, hai na? RTD is one of the easiest topic in CRE, okay? And highly scoring. You can easily get free marks. Hai. Wo gate wale bolte hai, free marks hai, jitne batorne bator lo. Theek hai? So you should pray that in gate exam, you should have at least one question from non-ideal reactor. Okay. Although if you see the history from 2000 to 2020 till now, they have asked more than 20 questions from RTD, non-ideal reactor system. And only in 2018 there was not a question, but every year at least there is a question. Sorry. Now next is T bar. How to calculate the mean residence time? So E curve is given. So we know that T bar can be calculated from E curve like this. So if you have the equation of ET in terms of time, you can put this equation here and solve. Here 0 means the time after which tracer molecules has started to leave the reactor. T equal to 0 has two meaning. First, T equal to 0 is the time at which we are injecting the tracer. Second, t equal to 0 is the time after which molecule has started to leave the reactor. So if you see this curve, molecule has started to leave the reactor after t equal to 3. So in bottom we will have 3 instead of 0. And infinity is the time at which the last molecule is leaving the reactor. Okay, so last molecule is leaving the reactor at 15, as you can see from the curve. So the infinity will be replaced by 15 over t into e t dt. But the point is, here if you see, for the time interval 3 to 8 and then 8 to 15, this curve has different slope. So it means I have to break this integration. Like for the time interval from 3 to 8, and let's say the function is even t now, plus integration from 8 to 15 t into function is, let's say, e2 now. Okay. Is it visible?
No.
Okay, no problem. So I can write it as here. Okay, now how to find out ET and E1T and E2T? See, it's very simple. Okay. For the first time interval between 3 to 8, this is the curve. Points are 3, 0, 8, 1 by 6, Emax. Okay, and let's say this is x1, y1, this is x2, y2. So the equation of a straight line connecting two points, we know that. That is y minus y1 is equal to y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1 times of x minus x1. So here y means et, x means t. So here if you put the values for this time interval, y means, let's say, even, t for the first curve, y1 is 0, y2 minus y1 is 1 by 6 minus 0, x2 minus x1 means 8 minus 3, x means t, x1 is 3. So you will get even t is equal to 1 upon 30 t minus 3, which is valid for this time interval only. So put that value of even t here, okay, and integrate and put the limits and solve. And for e2t, similarly, you can find out e2t for this curve, and you will get e2t is equal to minus 1 upon 42 15 minus t, sorry, t minus 15. And this will be valid for the time interval of 8 to 15 only. Okay, so put that e2t here and solve, you will get your answer, that is 8.7. okay, don't say it is the answer in a hurry, okay, because if you try to calculate the value, this part of the area of this part and area of this part, that will be different. It means 8 is the mean value, because at a t equal to 8 we cannot divide this curve into two equal parts. Okay, so that's why 8 is not the answer, 8.7. when you solve, you will get 8.66, or that can be rounded off to 8.7. okay, that is the answer, and I hope you can do that calculation. So that's not a big deal to solve this. So you can see that there are simple numericals from non-ideal reactor. Then fourth question, non-ideal reactor part, that we will see later on, the segregation model. And here, see, in question number 3, the E curve for a non-ideal reactor defines the fraction of fluid having age between T and T plus dt, where, and all of us have discussed that is at the exit, means at the outlet of the reactor. Option B, that is the correct answer. Okay. And since they are talking about the age, so based on age, there is one more thing which you should know. If you draw a E curve, suppose it is like this, and if you see this value T, okay, this is some fraction of tracer that is leaving the reactor, and this is some fraction of tracer that is leaving the reactor. Okay, so if you see this yellow fraction, that is leaving the reactor. Has the exit age, as I have told you that exit age and residence time are almost same, huh? Mm-hmm. Only by definition they are different, but by every other mean they are same, less than T. And all of us know that if anyone has the age less than us, or if our age is less than someone, then we are younger to them. So we can say this yellow fraction is basically younger to T. Younger fraction of tracer leaving the reactor than T. Okay. Similarly, the orange fraction here, you can see this has age, this the exit age of this fraction is more than T. So this is older fraction. Okay. So I hope older fraction than T. Than T. Because older, younger, all these are the relative terms. So I hope this is clear to all of you. So this is all about the pulse input experiment. Next is step input experiment. Step input method. See, step input method, again I am not drawing the setup, okay, just see the tracer input profile so that you can understand what is the meaning of step input. Step input means when we either step up or step down the input value and keep it constant. Okay, like before T equal to 0, suppose the tracer input was this 0, and after time T equal to T, we have step up the tracer input there and make it CT like this. So now the C or CT, nahi, actually I should say C naught. So now C naught concentration of tracer is entering in the system continuously at a constant rate. So this is a step input profile. And at the outlet profile, the tracer output profile here will be like this. And here we will not use the CT at the exit where we are detecting the tracer. We will use another notation that is called C step, because CT we have used in pulse input. And the since the input concentration is, see, this is the reactor where we are injecting the tracer. C naught concentration of tracer continuously. So what will be the molar flow rate of tracer going in the system? Molar flow rate. Of tracer going in the system will be V naught into C naught. Simple. I hope you understand this. So molar flow rate of tracer going in the system will be V naught into C naught, because we will introduce the tracer continuously here and mix with the feed, and we will make sure that the tracer is going in the system with the same flow rate. Okay, so the volumetric flow rate of tracer, the volumetric flow rate of feed will be same. So the maximum concentration of tracer that can leave at the outlet will be C0 obviously. So here if you try to draw the curve will be, the generalized curve will be something like this, where at t equal to infinite, the concentration at the outlet will be same as, concentration of the tracer at the outlet will be same as that of at, in the, that of at the inlet, C0. And here you can see we cannot calculate the area along the x-axis since that is one unbounded region. Tracer is coming in continuously, so obviously this curve will not, will never be going to touch the x-axis. Okay, so here we have to consider the area along the y-axis only. And that will be equal to t into dc step from 0 to C0. And mathematically if you see, I am writing directly, that value will come out to be C0 into tau, where tau is nothing but the mean residence time. Because you should know that for constant volume reaction system, the space time of every reactor, being it ideal or non-ideal, doesn't matter, the space time of every reactor will be same as its mean residence time. The space time of every reactor, every flow reactor will be same as its mean residence time. And in the step input method, since we have to inject the tracer continuously, okay, so that's why this method we cannot use for the batch reactor. We can use it only for the flow reactors, because batch reactor condition is we cannot have the continuous inlet or outlet. Okay. So in this type of questions, what you have to do, just calculate the area along the y-axis, then divide that by C0, you will get mean residence time. Simple. And if you want to know the profile, then C step will be equal to C0 1 minus e to the power minus t by tau. Okay, so here after doing the mole balance we will get this equation, and from this equation we have gotten this profile. Okay, although that is not the actual profile, that is the generic profile, the general form of the curve. Actual profile, if you try to draw from the same expression, that will be something like this. Okay. That will be the actual profile which you will draw from this equation. But in generalized form, we can write like this. Okay. And what is C step here? So you should know that here C step represents the cumulative concentration of tracer leaving the reactor. Cumulative concentration of tracer leaving the reactor at time t, because as you can see we have continuous inlet. Okay, continuously we are sending some tracer. So obviously at the outlet the amount of tracer leaving will increase with time. Okay, since we have the continuous input. So this is the cumulative concentration profile. In pulse input that was not the cumulative profile, that was the point value. But here we have the cumulative value. Okay. And after time t equal to infinite, that same C step will be same as C0, means the same concentration of tracer will leave the reactor as we are sending. Okay, at t equal to infinite. And here if you try, if you divide this C step by total concentration C0, Then that will become if you divide C step by the total concentration, this equation will become C step over C naught. That means a fraction. Cumulative value concentration divided by total concentration means fraction. And we can represent that by the term Ft. That will be equal to 1 minus e to the power minus t by tau. Or t bar, whatever you want to write, you can use. And the curve will be like Ft, and the maximum value will be 1, obviously, the cumulative fraction. And the curve will become like this. At t equal to infinite, this value will become 1. And the entire area, the equation of this area along the y-axis, which was this, that will be equal to tau only. And this curve is called F-curve, only for step input experiments. And what is Ft? Here Ft represents the cumulative fraction of tracer leaving the reactor at time t. Or otherwise you can simply write it as total fraction of tracer that has left the reactor till time t. That is Ft. That is the meaning. Okay. Okay, you can understand this easily. See, let's consider one simple example for the understanding what is Et and Ft here. Okay, see, if I, for any system, I have this data available. C naught is equal to 100. At t equal to 3, this is 7. At t equal to 7, this is 8. At t equal to 10, this is 9. Suppose. Okay. So if someone asks you, what is E7? Okay, so ET represents the fraction of tracer leaving the reactor at time t. So this value will be equal to 8 by 100. Okay, but if anyone asks you to calculate F7, then F7 is the total concentration of tracer that has left the reactor till time t. So here you have to add all these values. E0 plus So you have to add C0 plus C1 plus C2 plus C3 up to C7 and then divide those all those values by the term C0, total value concentration. You will get F7, that is the cumulative concentration. Okay, that is the meaning. Okay, so I hope it is clear to you all. Now, what is the meaning of ET and FT? ET represents the fraction of tracer leaving the reactor at time t, the point value. FT represents the fraction of tracer, total fraction of tracer that has left the reactor till time t, or you can say the cumulative fraction. So mathematically, if you want to see, so you should know that if dft over dt thus is equal to et, and ft is equal to integration from 0 to t of et dt. Means the slope of f curve, ft versus t means f curve. The slope of f curve is equal to et, and the area of E curve from 0 to time t is equal to ft. Okay, so this is something about the step input experiment. Next, the RTT for different reactors. Okay. So you should know that if I talk about the batch reactor, then batch reactor is considered as an ideal reactor. Since we are sending all the feed molecules at time t equal to 0 and taking out all of that reaction mixture at time t. So all molecules are spending same time. So that means every molecule in batch reactor have same residence time. So that is an ideal reactor. For PFR, plug flow reactor, the RTD is for the pulse input. See, RTD for different reactors, we are doing only for the pulse input. Okay, so if the pulse input function was delta T, so the RTD of the PFR will be delta of T minus tau P, where tau P is the space time of PFR. Okay, what is the meaning? See, the meaning is simple. If you consider a PFR like this, suppose a pulse is going in the system, or forget the pulse, yes, pulse is going in the system at T equal to 0. Okay, so there is no turbulence. We know that in PFR axial mixing is 0, so no turbulence. There is no possibility of any extreme corner, and bypassing is also not there. Bypassing means what? Molecules are following the shortest path. So here we already want that molecules should follow the shortest path. So bypassing is also not there. So there is no cause of non-ideality. So what will happen now? I am sending pulse at t equal to 0, but I will get the pulse, the same pulse in the outlet at time tau p. That is the space time of this PFR. Okay, there is no change in the profile. So what I can say that since profile is same, so it means in case of PFR, there is only a delay. Okay, and whenever there is a delay in the process, we can represent that delay by the term minus theta, t minus theta, like that. If you have studied PDC, Laplace transform, all those graph theories, so you must know that the delays are represented by t minus theta and leads represented by t plus theta, like that. So PFR just delaying the process, that's it. So that can also be considered as an one ideal reactor. For MFR, if I talk about one MFR where we have continuous feed, continuous product, and I am sending a tracer in the form of pulse input. C naught amount of tracer at t equal to 0 in the form of pulse. So the output profile here, Ct, kya hua? Here the output profile Ct will be equal to C naught e to the power minus t by tau m. After doing mole balance, you will get this expression. Means the C curve, since this is pulse input, so I can say that is the C curve. So C curve will be like this. At T0, concentration will be C0. and it will decrease exponentially as time progresses. So this is the C curve for MFR. And what is the RTD? See, the RTD, ET, you know that ET is how to calculate ET from CT. So just put this value of CT in that equation, ET equal to CT over area of C curve. So you will get ET is equal to e to the power minus t by tau m divided by tau m. And the curve will be like same as C curve, exponential decay. Okay, same as C curve. And this value will be, as you can see, at t equal to 0, this ET will be equal to 1 by tau m. So it means in case of MFR and in case of PFR, we can notice one thing. In PFR, if we have the tracer output profile or the RTD profile, just understand. So for PFR, if there is a delay, so you can simply say that delay is due to the space-time. So if you have the RTD curve for PFR or the E curve for PFR, so there you can watch the delay. And that delay must be equal to its space-time. So from there, you can calculate the space-time of PFR or the mean residence time of PFR. And if there is an MFR, E curve is given for pulse input. E curve is given. So you must know that at t equal to 0, this maximum value of E curve is equal to 1 by tau m. So from there, you can calculate the space time of MFR, or basically you can say the mean residence time of MFR. So that's how you can solve the problems related to MFR and PFR, and you can find out their space time or the mean residence time. So I hope it is clear to you. It's very simple. Okay, and again here, if you extend this E curve up to t equal to infinite, so obviously the area of this entire curve has to be 1. Remember, the area of E curve will be 1 always in the total time interval. So this is the RTD for batch reactor, PFR and MFR for pulse input. Now, if we have PFR and MFR in series, so understand that we have only two possible scenarios. First, PFR followed by MFR, or MFR followed by PFR. So here, if we are sending the pulse input at t equal to 0, so the RTD for both of these cases, both of these reactors will be same. Like space time for MFR is supposed tau m. For PFR, it is tau p. So the RTD curve will be like this. There will be a delay due to PFR of time tau p, and then there will be exponential decay because of the MFR. And this value must be equal to 1 by tau m. Okay, and mathematically you can write this function as, I hope you know how to write down the mathematical equations from a graph. Okay, so you can see when the time is less than tau p, in this region there is no molecule is leaving. Okay, means zero fraction is leaving. And when the time is greater than equal to tau p, then molecules has started to leave the reactor in an exponential decreasing manner. So the function will be like e to the power. For MFR, what was the function, if you remember? E to the power minus t by tau m over tau m. So since there is a delay of time tau p, so what to do? Just replace t by the term t minus tau p. Okay, so it will become t minus tau p over tau m divided by tau m. Like this. This will be the exponential function, the mathematical function for RTD of PFR and MFR in series. Simple. Okay, I hope it is clear to all of you. This is the RTD for MFR PFR in series. Now let's talk about the RTD for MFR and PFR in parallel. So if you send a pulse input here, okay, and if you try here, you will get the RTD for MFR that will be like this exponential decay. For PFR, there will be a delay of the time tau p. And if you draw both of these profiles on the same curve, so there is an exponential decay because of MFR and there is a delay because of PFR. So generally we represent that like this. This is the RTD for MFR and PFR in parallel. So that is all about the RTD for reactors, and I hope it is clear to all of you. Okay. Further, if you want to see the RTD for PFR in series, that also is there. See, if we have RTD for, let me discuss, okay. Like if we have to calculate, suppose the RTD for PFR in series. So I hope you understand that. At isothermal conditions, PFR in series can be replaced by single PFR of same equivalent volume. So here, if the volume is tau p1 plus tau p2, means the space time. So here the space time will be tau p1 plus tau p2. For individual PFR, if the space time is tau p1 and tau p2, so for the single PFR, space time will be tau p1 plus tau p2. And in that case, the RTD will be like this. There will be a delay of the time tau p1 plus tau p2. Okay. Similarly, if we have two PFR in parallel, and you are sending the pulse, then here the RTD will be like this. This is tau p1, this is tau p2. Condition is if tau p2 is greater than tau p1. Okay, or vice versa. So like that you can draw the RTD for PFR in parallel on the same curve. Okay. Similarly, if we have MFR in parallel for the RTD for pulse input, in this case will be same profiles will be there, okay, like this. And if here you can say this is 1 upon tau m1, this is 1 upon tau m2. Condition is tau m2 is greater than tau m1, or vice versa. So accordingly you can draw that. Okay, ultimately if you try to see, then the second curve will be overlapped under the first one, so we cannot see that there. So that's how the profile will be there. And if you have MFR in series, that is a different story. That is entirely a different story. Okay, so for that, we will study all that part as well. So let's have a quick break of 10 minutes. Okay, so after the break, we will discuss the RTD for MFR in series, basically the tank model and the other different reactor, non-ideal reactor models, and then the heterogeneous reaction system. So I hope this is clear to all of you guys. So that's going to be an interesting part of RTD for MFR in series and the different non-ideal reactor models. It is very easy, and understandable. Okay, so stay tuned, take care, be safe, and see you after 10 minutes. Ta-da.